Entering 2023, we've seen a growing number of countries stepping up their push to reduce reliance on the US dollar. Is the greenback not reliable anymore? And what plans have been drafted so far? And why is the buck supremacy facing challenges? I'm Pablo Chen, and this is Faxtel. Today, we're also joined by Professor Anton Fedyashin, the director of the Carmel Institute and associate professor at American University. Welcome to Faxtel. Before we dive into our discussion, let's do a quick count of the recent announcements made around the world that are related to the reducing exposure of the U.S. currency. In an interview earlier this month, French President Emmanuel Macron said Europe should reduce its dependence on the extraterritoriality of the U.S. dollar. His remarks came on the heels of a trade deal between French conglomerate Total Energies and China's offshore oil giant CNOOC, which marked the country's first ever LNG transaction settled in the yuan. Also, the BRICS nations, Brazil, Russia, India, China, and South Africa, have unveiled plans to create their own currency later this year. We've also seen plans made by Russia and Iran as they're working on a cryptocurrency backed by gold, a stable coin that could replace the dollar for use in transactions. Also in the news are Bangladesh and Russia having agreed to use the yuan to settle payment for a nuclear plant. And then there's discussion between the UAE and India to trade non-oil commodities in rupees. Malaysian Prime Minister said this month, there's no reason for Malaysia to continue depending on the dollar. The drive has also spread to South America as Brazil and Argentina are eyeing a joint currency named the SIR. Other Latin American nations will be invited to join, which could create the world's second largest currency union. Now, our foremost question is, why is the dollar status eroding at such an alarming pace?
And what we're all living through now, and have been for the past 30 years roughly, is the gradual de-Westernization of global affairs with new powerful actors, first and foremost China and India, but also Russia, to a certain extent the BRICS countries in general. They are beginning to claim their right to articulate, determine the rules by which the global economic and geopolitical game is played. And de-dollarization is one of the multiple manifestations of this much broader and much deeper process of the gradual de-Westernization and de-Americanization of international affairs and international economics. And the fact that the United States, over the past 10 years, has unfortunately weaponized its financial system and its currency, the dollar, all of that is simply contributing, it's speeding up a process that had begun before already, but never had the traction to actually move ahead. If 10 years ago, for example, we were doing this interview, and you asked me seriously what I thought of de-dollarization, you know, most people wouldn't take us seriously, but everyone's taking it seriously now. And frankly, I've lost track of the amount of world leaders who are talking about de-dollarization because it seems to be everyone outside of the United States.
When a country or region de-dollarizes, in simple terms, it reduces the dollar's dominance by introducing more competition. One way to do that is through replacing the dollar as the reserve currency. Okay, so what is reserve currency? This is important to know because reserve currency is one that is held in large amounts by governments as a supplement to their own currencies. And the dollar has reigned supreme as the world's global reserve for decades. The reason why everyone holds this currency is because it's supposed to help facilitate deals. So, it's supposed to make things easier for everyone, not harder. Nowadays, some countries are wary of the dollar as its stability and reputation have been weakened by a combination of factors. Some of the factors are financial and some are geopolitical. We will dissect the financial ones first. For example, the U.S. Congressional Research Service compiled a report last fall analyzing the current challenges to the dollar's global role. The rising inflation, higher interest rates, and slowing growth are some of the jazz factors being referenced. Earlier, U.S. economist Noriel Rubini, also predicted the financial crisis of 2008, wrote that the decline of the dollar as a reserve currency is likely over the next decade. Pessimism about the dollar was also conveyed in a speech this month by former U.S. President Donald Trump.
Our currency is crashing and will soon no longer be the world standard, which will be our greatest defeat, frankly, in 200 years. There will be no defeat like that.
And let's hear what our guest, Professor Fedyashin, has to say.
So far, the struggle to manage hegemonic decline, which is what the United States is going through, it's no longer the hegemon of the planet. It's just one of the great powers, although systemically, economically, it is still the most powerful one. But so far, it has failed to manage that decline intelligently and ably with nuanced, smart, creative foreign policy. And this seems to be a bipartisan problem because we hear from the Republicans here on Capitol Hill, statements that are basically carbon copies of Democratic policies. They're just expressed in slightly different language. So unfortunately for the United States, I don't see any radical changes, although at this point, even tactical shifts may end up benefiting the United States. But we'll have to wait until November of 2024, actually January 25, to see if anything actually changes.
Recently, billionaire Elon Musk, CEO of Tesla and Twitter, tweeted about his opinion on the dollar status in relation to the way the U.S. conducts its foreign policy. He described it as a serious issue. U.S. policy has been too heavy-handed, making countries want to ditch the dollar. Is the dollar still the safe haven currency for last resort? Or has it been used as a bludgeon of foreign policy? Here's what U.S. Treasury Secretary said in an interview this month.
This was the moment that the dollar's hegemony and its status as reserve currency began to falter.
So there is a risk when we use financial sanctions that are linked to the role of the dollar, that over time it could undermine the hegemony of the dollar.
Let's hear more from our guest in Washington, D.C., and hear about what he has observed.
But once the conscious decisions began being made in Washington to weaponize the dollar, that is what has been contributing mostly to the push for de-dollarization. And the irony is that the more sanctions the United States imposes on Russia currently or on any other countries, the faster the world will be moving away from the dollar. And we see this happening on a weekly basis. Every week for the past year, there have been new deals, new announcements, new plans coming out of world capitals about moving away from the dollar.
The trend of moving away from the dollar was foreshadowed years ago. A congressional report last year said Treasury officials in the Obama, Trump, and Biden administrations have cautioned that extensive use of financial sanctions could threaten the essential role of dollar and the U.S. financial system. As an example, European countries created a special purpose vehicle in 2019 to facilitate non-dollar humanitarian transactions with Iran to sidestep U.S. sanctions.
But then the sanctions started rolling in, plus the unpredictability of foreign policy decisions that were connected to sanctions, such as the Trump administration's abrupt withdrawal from the JCPOA with Iran, which immediately triggered the bring back of the reimposition of sanctions and put the Europeans into a very difficult position. That contributed even further. Then, of course, COVID contributed to generally disrupting international supply chains and trade links. And this, of course, was beyond the control of the United States or any other nation on the planet. But I would say that it was mostly the conscious decisions of the United States, both the Trump and especially the Biden administration, to start using financial and economic sanctions as a bludgeon to force countries to do what the United States decided was in those countries' best interests.
Currently, the U.S. dollar is still officially the world's global currency, which affords the United States economic and political advantage. The U.S. dollar was set as the global reserve currency and replaced the British pound in 1944 by the Bretton Woods Conference. Back then, the U.S. was the largest creditor nation in the world and provided funding to Britain, which was virtually bankrupt by the World War II. Fast forward to this century, the U.S. is no longer the largest creditor nation, but rather the largest debtor nation in the history of the world.
The world is moving through a very important recalibration of the global geoeconomic system and geopolitical system. The West, spoken broadly, defined broadly as a civilization, with the United States as its leader, is currently losing its hegemonic dominance of the rest of the planet, and new actors are rising. There are two ways to approach this. There is the smart way in managing this kind of hegemonic decline. There's an interesting example of this in the way that the British struggled with their role as a declining empire back in the 1940s and the 50s, not always successfully, but they managed to persevere. So far, the United States has made more uncalculated and poorly thought through moves than anything else. But I think that there's still hope for the U.S. to approach this in a nuanced and unemotional fashion. But unfortunately, I fear that this will necessitate a change of leadership in Washington, D.C.
So, is the dollar's era coming to an end? Well, let's not forget that today, the dollar is not the only reserve currency designated by the IMF. The euro, Chinese yuan, Japanese yen, and British pound are all designated as the international reserve asset in addition to the US dollar. So, as it stands right now, the dollar crisis is definitely something for all of us to be mindful of. Alright, this is all we have for today. Thanks for watching. If you like our show, don't forget to hit the like button and subscribe. I'm Pablo, see you next time.